Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Aparna Vatve, faculty of Tata Institute of Social Sciences. This module is about Indian Act and Policy on Coastal Zone. It is part of paper Environment and Society. In this module, we will first look at coast and coastal communities in India. Then we will take a look at coastal regulation zone and the draft of coastal management zone. In the end, we will try and understand how people reacted to these different notifications. India is surrounded by sea on all three sides. We have about 8,000 kilometers of coastline. This includes the east coast, the west coast, and also includes islands in Lakshadweep and Andaman Nicobar. It touches 13 states and union territories. Coast is the interface between sea and the land. Coastline differs in many ways from the mainland. It is constantly changing. At the high tide, sand is deposited by the seawater. In the low tide, the seawater recedes and takes away part of the sand. If we continue to look at the coast is changing every single minute. If we take a look at the coastline from the past and present, we can see how it keeps on altering all the time. It is a dynamic environment. Coastal beaches can be seen to change from one place to another. Sometimes they are sandy, in other places they are rocky. Coastal areas have many types of ecosystems. Mangrove forests are present in the estuarine region. This is the region where the river waters meet the sea. Coral reefs are seen in island areas. Beds of sea grasses, mudflats, and different types of shores are seen on the coast area. These habitats have their own unique plant and animal diversity. There are marine algae on the coast. We also have mammals that live exclusively on the coast. Indian territory extends into the sea beyond the coastline. Deep sea has a diversity of fish and large mammals like whales and dolphins. Some deep sea animals can come into the shallow waters for breeding. Shallow seas have a totally different biodiversity. The coast is vulnerable to many natural disasters. There is increasing frequency of cyclones along the east coast. Tsunamis have also happened. It has been proved that if the ecosystem of the coast is robust, it can protect us from the natural hazards. Dense mangrove forest, seashores, healthy coral reefs are all important in the protection of the mainland of India. People have always lived on or near the coast. Coastal climate is not too harsh. There is ample food that can be caught very easily. All the necessary food items can be collected or grown on the coast. This is one of the reasons why coasts are so densely populated today. There are many types of livelihoods which are seen only along the coast. People engage in marine fisheries. Estuarine fisheries are very different. There are communities which live along the coast and make salt. Agri or agaria communities specialize in making salt. Coastal agriculture includes growing rice on large coastal areas. There is also horticulture. Dense groves of coconut, areca nut are seen along the coastal areas. In Kerala, coasts have large plantations of spices. India has been trading along the sea routes for more than 2000 years. Seaports are important for trade. Cities came up first as trading towns. Mumbai and Chennai became important because of their coastal locations. Oil and natural gas extraction industries are seen along the east and west coast. There are places where nuclear power plants are being built. Tourism and luxury housing are also competing for growing along the coast. each wants a piece of the coast. Industry wants to use the coast for making money. They want to manage the coast in such a way that industrial development takes place. Coastal fishermen and farmers are trying to protect their own agriculture, horticulture, and fisheries. Coast is our national border. Defense establishment are necessary on the coast and islands. At the same time, we need a healthy coastline, and coastal biodiversity is important for the well-being of the coastal ecosystems. Environmental lobby is campaigning to protect the coast for its unique and globally important biodiversity. Government has to take a very clear stand to balance all these different interests. Such a stand was taken through an environmental notification specifically for the coastal area. India already has Environmental Protection Act. Provisions of Environmental Protection Act are applicable to all of India. But Coastal Regulation Zone notification was created specifically for the coasts. This is because the coast in some ways is very special. The first notification was made in 1991. After that, it has been amended for around 25 times. Finally, it was reissued in 2011. Coastal Regulation Zone is under Environmental Protection Act. It was created to conserve and protect unique environment of coast and marine area. It also protects livelihood security of the coastal communities. It has provisions to protect the livelihoods of the subsistence fishermen. Development of the coast has to be done in an environmentally sustainable manner. Provisions of this notification are quite complicated. First, it describes a coastal regulation zone. This zone is described based on the high and low tide lines, which need to be mapped. A landward distance of 500 meters from the high tide line comes under the coastal regulation zone. There are separate distances for the creeks and other tidal influenced water bodies. These include estuaries and brackish water lakes. Chilka is one example. As per this notification, each coastal state was supposed to prepare a coastal zone management plan. In this, they had to map all the coastal regulation zone categories and subcategories of the zone. Activities that do not require waterfront are mostly prohibited in this notification. Prohibited activities include setting up of new industries, expansion of existing industries which deal in hazardous waste are also stopped. Land reclamation, bunding, or disturbing the natural course of water are regulated. Waste disposal units are prohibited on the coast. Despite this, we see a lot of waste being thrown into the sea. Sometimes the waste from the cities actually moves down to the coastal rural areas. The CRZ areas are classified into four categories. CRZ 1 are the most ecologically sensitive areas. In this, geomorphological features play a role in maintaining the integrity of the coast. This includes the mangrove forest, corals, sandy and rocky beaches, and biologically active mudflats. This is also an area between the low tide line and the high tide line. No new constructions are permitted within 500 meter distance from the high tide line. Coastal regulation zone second area are areas that have been developed up to or close to the shoreline. These will mainly include the human use areas. CRZ 3 areas are relatively undisturbed and do not belong to either CRZ 1 or 2. These include coastal zone in the rural areas and areas within the municipal limits or in the legally designated urban areas which are not substantially built up. So basically it means small towns on the coast. CRZ-4 includes the water area from the low tide line to 12 nautical miles on the seaward side, as well as the water area of the tidal influence water body from the mouth of the water body at the sea up to the influence of tide. According to this classification, there are further restrictions about different kinds of construction activities in each zone. For all this, it is first important to map the tide lines. CRZ has many provisions to ensure that the coast is not polluted or totally taken over by big buildings or is not reclaimed by commercial purpose constructions. Dressing or altering the sand dunes, hills, natural features including landscape changes for beautification, recreation are all prohibited or strictly regulated. There are certain exceptions which are separately listed. Kerala and Goa states depend on coastal tourism. A lot of foreign tourists come to these states just for the beauty of the beaches and of the backwaters. Backwater and beach tourism is an exception which has to be regulated in a separate way as per the coastal regulation zone. In some places, critical vulnerable coastal areas are identified. These are unique habitats with rich biodiversity. The Sundarban forest is one such example. These are also ecologically sensitive areas which are to be managed with the involvement of local coastal communities. Endangered marine turtles come to breed on the east and west coast of India. Once upon a time, they were threatened by the coastal activities. Today, there are people's groups which have come up and they help to ensure the breeding success of these turtles. They have protected areas along the coast where the turtles come regularly. This is a very good example of how biodiversity protection is supported by local communities. The notification has led to creation of the Coastal Zone Management Authority. Any project on the coast has to get a clearance from this activity. In 2005, a committee was formed to take a re-look at the coastal areas. It was chaired by Professor M.S. Swaminathan, a renowned agricultural scientist. He is also known as the father of Green Revolution. The committee wrote a report recommending a move towards integrated coastal zone management. It proposed the replacement of the CRZ notification with the Coastal Management Zone notification. The draft CMZ notification led to extensive protest by the coastal communities. Coastal fishing communities felt that this change would result in uncontrolled development of the coast. It will lead to complete loss of livelihoods of the fishing community. According to the Marine Fisheries Census of 2005, there are 3,202 marine fishing villages on the coast. A total of 3.52 million people live along the mainland coast of India. Nearly half of this population is engaged in active fishing and fishing-related activities. The price of fishing inputs has increased. Fish resources are depleting because of over-harvesting. There is also large-scale destruction of marine habitats. There is a stiff competition between fishing grounds of the traditional fishermen and the commercial fisheries. Incomes of subsistence fishermen are decreasing and fishing is becoming unviable. Globalization is further complicating this process. Big companies have entered the traditional habitats of fishermen. The process of CRZ notification and its changes are very closely watched by the fishermen communities. They had noticed many gaps in the earlier CRZ notification. But overall, they were quite happy about the provisions of CRZ. In fact, they said that it was one of the few good things that had happened to them and that was done by the government. CRZ protected small-scale fisheries. It had provisions to protect common coastal lands. It could control mindless development and coast grabbing. There were some disputes between the fishing community and the government about the coastal national parks. But generally, the fishing community was satisfied with the earlier CRZ. Swaminathan Committee's first report was opposed because it was trying to dilute the CRZ notification. They believed that it was opening up the coast for large development and mega projects. Fishing community are the largest stakeholders in the coastal zone. Along with other coastal communities, they created strong protest all along the coastal areas. Rallies were organized, meetings were held in villages. Environmental organizations and social activists also expressed their opposition to the Swaminathan Committee's report. National Fish Workers Forum organized several mass protests against the Swaminathan Committee's recommendations. All concerned organizations came together under one umbrella. It was called the National Coastal Protection Campaign. They challenged the Ministry of Environment and Forest. The campaign also made it a political issue in all the coastal states. It sent out a very loud and clear message that the fishing community of India does not want the coastal management zone notification. In 2009, another committee was formed. It was once again chaired by Professor Swaminathan. Report of this committee was called the Final Frontier. This report started by pointing out that the draft CMZ notification had lapsed. It suggested that the first Coastal Regulation Zone 1991 notification can be kept as the basic framework and suitable changes can be made to take account of the needs of the coastal communities. At the same time, pressure of population and development activities was growing. Coastal resources and biodiversity both had to be considered. Devastations due to severe cyclones, storm surges, and sea level rise threatened coastal areas. Climate change has been leading to rising sea levels. It has submerged low-lying areas in Sundarbans. In coastal Orissa, parts of the village land have totally disappeared into the sea. The committee reported testimonies of fishermen. These testimonies described how the fishermen were fighting against the large development activities. In the agenda for the future, committee stated that there is a need to introduce regulations to manage the proliferation of ports along the coast with possible impacts on the coastline. They pointed out the need to understand cumulative impacts on the coastline. The committee noted that currently the shoreline of the country is undergoing a major change because of the large number of port and harbor projects. There was a lot of dredging, shore protection work, and land reclamation. It was clear that such developments were a threat to the coast. The beaches and shoreline have been degrading. The committee suggested to take cognizance of all this while making the new plans of management. The final Coastal Regulation Zone 2011 notification was generally welcomed by the fishing community. In most respects, it is similar to the CRZ 1991. It regulates activities in the same 500 meter zone from the high tide line. Preamble very clearly states that the objective is to protect coastal biodiversity and livelihood security of the coastal communities. It mentions that sustainable development is to be done with scientific principles, taking into account the dangers of natural hazard in the coastal areas and sea level rise due to global warming. Protection of the rights of the traditional coastal communities is mentioned in many places. There are separate notifications which regulate development activities on the islands. Annexure 1 provides guidelines for the preparation of coastal zone management plan. It says that in these areas, fishing villages, common properties of the fishermen, and other development will be listed. Fishing jetties, ice plants, fish drying platforms, all will be documented. It also includes infrastructure like dispensaries, roads, and schools. All this will be mapped on a proper scale. State shall prepare long-term detailed plans for housing of the coastal fisher communities. It will include expansion and all the other needs. Provisions of basic services like sanitation, safety, and disaster preparedness will be taken into account. This notification took care of the needs of the fishermen for today and for future. CRZ 11 recognized the fact that fishermen are living close to the coast. Many controversial projects have started on the coast. One is in Jaitapur in Maharashtra and another is Kudnakulam in Tamil Nadu. There is a dispute between fisher and farmer communities and government about both these projects. In both places, people have protested very strongly, but the government has not accepted. CRZ notification was relaxed in many ways for these two projects. It is feared that these projects will destroy the livelihoods of people with hazardous emissions. If a natural disaster strikes, there will be a catastrophe. Construction of jetties, ports, large resorts, and monuments in the sea within critical areas are all being challenged in the court. Implementation of coastal regulation zone notification is failing in many places because of economic pressure. Even basic identification of protection zone is not complete in many areas. Coastal India is under pressure. Ecological values of the region are taking a back seat. This will have far-reaching effects on the livelihoods of the people. Coastal communities are fighting to uphold the law. We all can join in this as citizens of India. If you are interested in this subject, you can take a look at our e-text. You can also look at some of the material given in essential readings. I hope you have enjoyed this module. Thank you.